One of the things that scientists do when they try to look at changes in the global climate system is they try to look at a number of different measures to see if indeed they're getting a consistent picture of change. So on this first slide, we have a series of indicators looking at changes in the global climate system. A number of thermal or temperature indicators are on this slide. And what we see, and you can see this by the arrows, all those thermal indicators are going up over time, particularly over the last several decades. And the sea ice and snow cover indicators are going down, as you'd expect, as the temperature increases. Now, we have a number of different ways in which we measure temperature. Probably the most common is the land surface over the globe, land surface air temperatures. You can see a general rise in temperature, especially over the last several decades. The different colored lines represent different analysis teams analyzing the data. Again, these data go back to 1880 and come up right through the present time. There are other indicators with different periods of record, also related to temperature indicators. The ocean heat content, particularly since about 1990, the ocean heat content has increased in a significant way. Ocean heat content is a very important indicator of changes. Most of the additional heat energy goes into raising the ocean heat temperatures. 93% of the increased heat energy over the last several decades has gone into warming the ocean temperatures, and only 3% has gone into warming the land surface temperatures. There's another 3% of heat that has gone into melting snow cover in the northern hemisphere, and only 1% gone into warming the atmosphere. We can actually look at atmospheric temperatures. You can see a gradual increase in temperatures, different analysis teams finding somewhat differences in terms of overall changes. A lot of variability from year to year, but overall increases. Next, we want to talk about near-surface monthly temperatures across all the land masses during the summer in the northern hemisphere. Most of you are familiar with the normal distribution. We all had that in school. We all got graded on the curve at one time or another. And it turns out that monthly temperatures across the northern hemisphere can follow a normal distribution quite closely. If we look at the temperatures from the 30-year period, 1951 to 1980, we see about a third of the data falling into what we would call above normal category, and only about a tenth of 1% falling into the extremely warm temperature category. As the decades unfold, however, more of the data begins to fall into the above normal category. For those of you familiar with the normal distribution, three standard deviations above normal. 1991 to 2001, 5% of the data now falling in the extremely warm category, three standard deviations, and 55% compared to 33% in the above normal category. And finally, for the period 2001 to 2011, two-thirds of the data